I was a grown woman before I realized that one of the things I'd missed out on by being a child star was the opportunity to develop close, long-term female friendships. I always felt like an adult. I was always around adults much more than children, and my dreams were adult dreams about a career. Through my teens, I was on the road, surrounded by my family and band members, and then it seemed like the minute I got to be a grown-up woman in my early 20s, my world was dominated by the fast party life. I never seemed to meet anybody normal.
Hello, everybody, and welcome again to On the Record. This week, we're going to share the pages, the memories of another wonderful book, the long-awaited autobiography of Tanya Tucker. And I want to show you the cover. The book is called Nickel Dreams, and I'll tell you in a moment why, but it's a beautiful cover. And Tanya always said that when she finally agreed to write a book, she would call it Nickel Dreams because of a song written by Nashville songwriter Mac McAnally. And the song is about a little girl who dreams of becoming a singer. Once she does, she finds out it wasn't exactly what she had counted on. Well, I took an excerpt from the book to give you some idea of the song and why the book is called Nickel Dreams. This is Mac's song, or a bit of it. It's taken a long time, and she's walked a thin line, but the fame and the fortune arrive. She kept on striving, halfway surviving, till part of her dreams came alive. And she wishes she looked like they tell her she looks all the time. What she'd give just to feel like she tells them she's feeling just fine. All that money she makes every night ain't so much as it seems. It's a dollar a wrinkle, and less than a nickel, a dream. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our star, Miss Tanya Tucker.
Tanya, welcome to our show.
Thank you.
Let's have a seat.
All right.
Tanya, congratulations on your book. I have just finished your book, and I found it to be most candid, most intriguing. I think it's going to be a big hit.
Well, I hope you're right.
You decided to be very candid in this book about alcohol, drugs, sex.
Well, I probably wasn't as candid as, or
did if you that's leave the out word. A lot?
That, oh, I mean, you can't put everything in. There's too many people that have to die first.
You were a little girl with a burning desire to be a singer.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Your father picked up on that, mm-hmm. decided he would help you.
Exactly. Which all of our relatives thought was crazy.
Did they really?
Oh, they thought he was nuts.
And I want to talk about your first trip to Nashville and why you came here. Came here, I guess, when you were about nine?
Nine, exactly. We came here from Wilcox, Arizona. And my dad thought we were just going to take the big step and go. And, of course, he purchased a Cadillac. I thought it was brand new. It looked brand new to me, but I guess it was slightly used. I don't know. But it got repossessed when we got home. But he thought you had to have a Cadillac to come to Nashville. And, of course, it backfired when we got here because he's thinking, man, these people are going to think we're rich. We better park down the street, you know. So we ended up having to park down the street and walk up, you know. But we did that. We went to every record label in this town, and my dad, you know, they'd try to stop him going in, and you can't go in there. And my dad says, "Where's Chet?" I mean, he was very he wasn't to be messed with.
You sort of got sidetracked. You did, not both.
Yeah, I did.
And you sort of disappointed him, didn't you?
Oh, very much. Yeah.
I mean, you wanted to go see the Grand Ole Opry, and you wanted to see all the things that everybody else wanted to see. And he wanted you to concentrate on trying to get a break.
Yeah, or concentrate on singing the songs when I was in the studio. And, of course, I always say I thought meter was something you stuck a nickel in. I really hadn't had no vocal training or of any sort. And so my timing was a little off.
Did you cut a demo session when you were here?
Yes, at a place called Exit Studios.
Tell me about your daddy taking you to the Hall of Fame and showing you the walkway.
Well, that was the next stop, because I was, you know, about in between takes, I would say, I want to go to the Grand Lobby. It was just, I think like my kids were treat. I think he probably felt like the way I felt at Christmas this year when we had to kind of put Christmas off. My kids, can we open the presents now? I mean, I bet you I heard that 5,500 times. And that was probably the way he felt. I just kept saying it, kept wanting. Finally, he grabbed me. He said, you're going to go to the Grand Ole Opry. You're going to go right now. And I remember what I had on, you know. And we stopped by the Hall of Fame. And I've got home movies of they took of me and my dad. And he was just very angry with me. And he said, you just look down here at all these stars, because that's all you're going to be doing, you know. He said, that's all.
All you're going to be doing,
yeah,
is looking?
Yeah. And he said, we can't afford to get in. It was, I think, $1.50 to get in. And he said, we can't afford to get in. He said, now I'm going to take you to the Grand Ole Opry now. So we went to the Grand Ole Opry, stood in line, and we got in, and it was hot. You know how hot it was, the old Ryman. And I watched Roy Acuff, yo-yo, and and all the twiddling the thing on his nose and all that.
Oh, the fiddle bow.
Yeah, that thing that, and of course, I guess I don't have a good memory of it because I felt so bad and I knew my dad was angry at me, so I really wasn't going to enjoy it. I could have been Disney World, I probably wouldn't have enjoyed it. But he said, now you make your decision and you won't be sitting down here watching, you won't be up there with him. And I looked at my dad and I said, I'd rather be up there on stage than down here.
I want to introduce now a character into this story that's going to lead us to Delta Dawn. Dolores Fuller.
Mm-hmm.
Who is she?
I was watching an Elvis movie. We didn't have much furniture, but we did have a TV. And as the credits rolled, there was her name at the end of the credits. And my dad said, you know, that woman lives here in town. And I said, well, why don't you call her? He said, well, she's not going to be listed. I said, well, how do you know? So we got down and had a phone book, too, came along with the house. And we looked in there, and there her number was. So he called her and said he had a daughter he wanted her to hear me sing. And we met, and that kind of, and she heard my tapes, and she kind of just took it on.
I think she heard these demos that you had
she was a songwriter,
recently
too.
Cut there in
right.
Las Vegas.
Mm-hmm. She had written songs. She wrote like Roustabout, a lot of the movie songs for Elvis.
Dolores Fuller knows this guy in Nashville named Billy Sherrill.
Yeah, she said Billy Sherrill was definitely the person that we needed to see, and we'd already heard his name before, and we'd sent him some tapes, but of course they got sent back. And these cannot be of any use to us. Blah blah blah. You know, one of those regular form letters. But she kept saying, this is the person. So Billy's been known to gamble a little bit, and Las Vegas is the place to go. So she called us one night and said, he's in town. Come up. I got a meeting. We're meeting tomorrow. And she, I guess, had bugged him all night long on the crap table. You know, he likes to play crap. So I think Al Gallico was with him, and, you know, he was up or down 37,000. So I remember that figure. And she got him off the crap table and said, listen, so I have a lot to thank her for, you know. She did that for me. And
Billy like you?
No, Billy instantly,
he liked
yeah.
He like your tapes?
Well, he said, I want to see her. And the next day, I remember what I had on. In fact, I think it was the same outfit that I have on right there, the red velvet. It was hot pants that my mother made me, the white go-go boots. And I walked into the Riviera coffee shop with my dad and my mother, and Billy Sherrill was there, along with Al Gallico, along with Bobby Vinton, and Billy's wife, and Dolores. So we all got one of those round booths like this, you know. And, and I sat directly across from Billy, and they were doing the small talk, you know. Everybody's so, you know, how's the weather, you know?
Yeah.
And Billy just looked at me and said, "When you want to come to Nashville to cut a hit record?"
So you do come to Nashville?
Yeah, we did. We went to Nashville. That was in. I met him in. I'd say it seemed like it was late in the year. But no, it had to be earlier. But I think I went to Nashville sometime in November
Billy saw Bette Midler sing Delta
yes.
Dawn
mm-hmm.
on The Tonight Show.
Right.
And he remembered the song.
The way I remember it is he told me, he said, I heard some chick sang a song on The Tonight Show last night. And it's called Delta Dawn. I think it's a smash. And so he played it, and he played Alex Harvey's demo.
Alex wrote it.
Yeah. And
Larry Collins?
Yeah, with Larry Collins. Well, there's different stories on that too.
Okay. We've got a video presentation off of an old show produced by this corporation called That Good Old Nashville
yeah,
Music.
Yeah, oh yeah, I remember it very well.
And Tanya is 13 here and singing. You know, here you're 14
yeah.
because you did two songs. You did Delta Dawn and you did What's Your Mama's Name. Let's go
did
for
I
Delta
have the
Dawn.
Black and white and yellow outfit on.
Let's see.
In her young days, they called her Delta Dawn.
Look at that. What goes through your mind?
Just, I don't know. I don't know. Just good memories, really. I mean, I wasn't so bad.
That's true. You weren't. Tanya, I want to show this historical cover of Rolling Stone magazine, which is basically a rock and roll magazine.
That's right.
Or newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
But when you were 15, they put you on the cover. You were the first country artist.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Well, read what it says there.
Hi, I'm Tanya Tucker. I'm 15, and you're going to hear from me.
Elvis was one of your heroes, wasn't he?
Oh, yeah.
Did you ever meet Elvis?
Yes, I did.
Where'd you meet him?
I met him in Las Vegas. I was 17 when I first met him.
What was your impression?
Oh, I adored him. I thought he was great. I mean, it was a whole other story for that, but it was, I remember every little single moment of that night. And
what kind of shape was Elvis in?
Well, he was heavy, you know. He was wearing the black suits. And but I loved every inch of him. I mean, I thought he was just when I sat down, we were sitting much closer than you and I are, and I probably would have been intimidated at this time meeting him, but I was a kid then, so nothing really scared me. And he tried, but...
What do you mean he tried?
Well, he was just very, like, you know, sits down like this close to me, you know, how you doing, baby? Fine. You had a breath mint lately?
Was he stoned?
No, it was beautiful.
Okay.
No, he was really beautiful. He wanted me to come to the party after the second show, but I said, I gotta go home and tell my mom and dad about this.
You followed his career, and I know that you were very sorrowful when he died.
Yes, very much.
And you went to his funeral, didn't you?
Yeah, well, I went to the viewing. I really couldn't handle going to the funeral. I was in Memphis, but I just stayed in my hotel room and watched it on television because, and they'd asked me why I didn't go, but I'd seen enough. I mean, I went to the viewing the night before at Graceland, and I think that was when I made a vow that I'd never go to another funeral.
You expressed in the book some observations about Elvis's funeral that you didn't like.
Well, I just, you know, there was just a lot of people around that I felt like really directly contributed to his death. And a lot of those people were so-called great friends of his.
You mentioned that he was buried in a tacky suit.
It was a light blue polyester suit with a big white tie, and his hair was... show the blonde roots, you know, you could see the blonde roots. And I don't know if it was because I didn't want it to be him or maybe it wasn't him, but it didn't look like him. Yeah. I mean, he was very thin. And I had known Elvis before I thought, well, you know, I mean, maybe they do that when they embalm or take all that stuff out. Maybe that, I mean, he was very small and just, I don't know, it just didn't look like him. But maybe I was just wanting it not to be,
you know. So you think?
I didn't think it was him.
You went into some sort of denial then?
I think so. And to this day, I don't really know if it was him. I mean, I don't know if he's alive now, but I think he was still alive at that time.
Do you really?
I believe that, yeah.
You don't think that was Elvis in the casket?
No.
Interesting. No. Okay. Daniel, we are celebrating on this program a book called Nickel Dreams, your autobiography, long awaited by many people who are fans of yours. And you're very explicit about a lot of things that I'm sure will surprise people. Sex is one. You mentioned when you lost your virginity.
I've never been as promiscuous as everybody seems to think.
Well, you didn't hide what some people would call promiscuity in many instances in this book.
Well, you have to level. I mean, on certain things. I mean, there's probably things that I didn't tell that. The only reason I wouldn't have is if it would have hurt someone else. I'm not really afraid of hurting me. I mean, I always worry about someone else's feelings. And that's what's really catch 22 about writing a book. You really...
Yes.
It really is tough.
All that having been said, let's talk about Glenn Campbell.
All right.
Was this... let me go back a few years and tell you that I understood from Glenn that it was very difficult for him to write about you in his book. Was it difficult?
I'm glad to hear that.
Was it difficult for you to write about the Glenn Campbell episode in your life?
It was difficult to a point, but there were so many activities and so many stories to tell that really it wasn't that difficult. The only difficult part would be that I really don't want to hurt him. And we had a great love for each other. And it's just really sad when you have to tell on someone. And I really don't like that. But when he wrote his book, I felt like that opened my door a little bit wider.
You didn't agree with his book, did you?
Some parts, no. Some of the parts that were just, I thought, I mean, if he'd call me, I mean, I sent him a message and said, hey, call me and let me check some of these stories out with you, make sure they're all right. So, because I have no desire to hurt Glenn Campbell. And I was worried that they were trying to buy my revenge for him, and it's just not for sale.
Who would try to buy your revenge?
Well, the people
publisher?
The publishers, yeah. And I think that, you know, this is my second publisher. First publishers didn't work out.
Because book wasn't hot enough or something?
Well, they just wanted more of the sex, drugs, and rock and roll. They weren't interested in the beginnings of my career, which I think are really some of the best parts of my life.
Glenn Campbell, the first real love of your life?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Now, what would you like for our audience to know about that relationship?
Well, I think it was a very, very, it was volatile because it was very intense. I think both of us really cared about each other and really loved each other. At the same time, there was a big age difference, and that does matter.
44 and 21.
Yeah. Even though I'm much more mature, there are a lot of things he wasn't very mature about. We used to have little fights. I said something that a cow was a mammal. And he said, no, it's not. Yes, it is. So we'd get into little fights like that, but a cow is a mammal, isn't it?
I'm not going to fight with you.
But, there was a lot of things, and I think that probably... Anytime drugs or alcohol come into a relationship, it makes it...
You did a lot of cocaine with Glenn Campbell.
Well, that's how I was introduced to it. So, you know, that's really... I did not do that before I met Glenn.
What attracted you to him?
I met him at the Opry that night in 73 when I first met him.
Oh, okay. This is
when
he
got his autograph, and he was talking to Johnny Cash, and he kind of goes, here, and I go, hey. But the next time was at the CMAs when he had the problem with Mac Davis that night, and he had to get on a Learjet, get out of town. And then I saw him, I guess what it was in August, I saw him in Las Vegas. I guess it was 77. And went to see a show, and after the show, we got together. And of course, at that time, he was still married. So that was a taboo for me. And but it wasn't working out, and he had told me the marriage just wasn't gonna last. And then I went back up to see him in Tahoe. That's when he told me that Sarah was pregnant.
He'd so married really, Sarah Davis.
Yeah. So that really really knocked some holes in my sails. And I said, well, you know, then this just don't bother me anymore until you're divorced. And because this is not my way of doing things. I mean, I really cared about it. Of course, there was, I think, a little bit of the adulation, too, you know, kind of like the Tammy and George thing, where really, really had a lot of admiration for his talent. And I still do.
Yeah, you mentioned the fact that you said he's a great showman. He even did a show, played the guitar with a broken arm.
Oh, yeah.
And I thought you were very nice to him in the book.
Well, I hope to be. I don't want to...
Except for the time he knocked your two front teeth out.
Well, that was...
Why did you fight so much?
I think probably, you know, the sticks and stones won't hurt my bones, but words can never... But I think it was just the other way around with me. When he would call me a name or accuse me of something that I definitely hadn't done, it was so ridiculous, I would lash out. I would get very angry. We had many fights. I mean...
Do you think the fights were caused by the drugs?
I think toward the end, yes, toward the end, but not in the beginning.
What finally, how long were you...
But he was always on drugs. He was always doing drugs, using when I was with him.
How long were you lovers? How long did the affair last?
3 years.
What ended the affair?
I was in, Bossier City, Louisiana in September 24th, 25th, and 26th of, what year was that? He was playing a show in Dallas, and he'd get a Learjet and come see me, then get the Learjet, go do his show, then come back. And when he came back, he was, he'd been either drinking or doing something, and I was not allowed to even talk with my own band. I was not allowed to just talk with them or be around them, except on stage. I mean, that was basically it. And at that time, I had a band that was really religious. I mean, very religious. So these guys were like, whoa, what? They just didn't understand him at all. And
so he was very controlling.
Very much. Oh, incredibly so. I mean, I couldn't even go in the next room with one of my girlfriends.
Whose idea was it for you to split?
Well, it was mine. He came in that night, and he started slapping me around. So I immediately became a rattlesnake, and was fixing to, was biting back. And finally, I gave him a big kick in the stomach, and I said, "Leave me alone." And then that was all it took. And here he comes. So I'd hit him, and he fell against a table and cut his head open. So he's bleeding profusely, you know. So I said, get in the other room. I was angry. And so he went in the other room, and of course, that lasted for about 30 minutes. And then pretty soon, both doors came down between the rooms. And then that's when the police came. So that was basically it. And they, instead of taking him to jail, they put him in another room way across the hotel. And the next morning, he left, and that was it. The next time I saw him, it was October 6th, 4 days from my birthday. I was opening at John Esquaga's Nugget in Reno, And he was opening on the 8th, I believe, in Tahoe at Harrah's. So he had called me many times, and I had a bodyguard at that time, too. So we were staying in a house right outside of Reno, and I had all the phones and the operators shut off all calls coming from Glenn, even to my band, because he would try to call the band. And then I got a call one night from Loretta Lynn. I go, oh, great, put it through. And it was Lynn. So he'd used her to get in to talk to me. And I said, oh, God. And that was pretty much it.
I want to move on to another period of your life, which had to be traumatic. That's when you went to the Betty Ford Center.
Yeah.
1989?
88. February of 88, yeah.
The book depicts this episode in your life as one in which you didn't want to go, and you were sort of set up by your family and friends. Tell me about that.
Well, it was the intervention. You've heard about the intervention deal. And it was one morning about 8 o'clock, and I'm not a morning person, like I said. My dad had said that Jim Fogelsong wanted to meet with me at his home at 9:30. And I don't know why I didn't.
He's head of your label, Capitol Records.
He was at that time.
By now, you've gone to Capitol Records. He was head of the label that signed you.
Oh, yeah. And, of course, Jerry Crutchfield was there, my mother, my dad, my brother, and the rest of the group. And, they just proceeded to just shower down on me. And I'm still not one of my fondest memories, and I really don't look back on it with any kind of appreciation at all. I know my parents and my family were there because they thought that was the best, they were doing the best that they could. But not many of the friends that were there are around anymore.
You did this, I guess, to satisfy your
mother. And some of the friends that were there are back on drugs again, so, you know.
I guess you did this to really, satisfy your mother and father.
Yes, I
family.
Did. Absolutely, because the guy stood up at the end from Betty Ford, and he said, these people want to help you. The main people I was concerned with was my dad and my mother. And when my dad sort of started breaking down and crying, and it really, really got to me, and they said, well, we want you to go. And I go, well, when? We went right to the airport from there.
Bo broke down crying, begging you to go, didn't
yeah.
he? How was it at Betty Ford for you?
It was the worst. It was the pits, yeah. I mean, it was, I'm glad, there's a lot of things I'm glad for. I'm very glad that I had a male counselor, because I would have never made it with some of the other counselors there. He was very good. His name was Herb. And it was tough because, it's a four-week program. But after 4 weeks, they couldn't get inside of me. I mean, I'm not going to sit around and tell a few people. I mean, there were six people in group therapy. My intimate, most inward feelings. I mean, I figured they'd get out and tell the Inquirer. Why would I talk to people that are just going to rat on me?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he was going to say
you
these people.
You didn't trust these people.
Absolutely not. So he said he realized that right there, right away, I needed just one-on-one therapy with him. And that's what we started doing, a lot of that, because he realized I couldn't do that. But they kept me 6 weeks, which is more than they keep any hardened criminal.
Didn't you become...
I mean, because I think a lot of it was because they wanted me to stay because I was helping other girls.
I got the impression, after I read that though you didn't want to go, that somehow the experience was enriching for you before it was over.
It was more enriching just because of because I saw that I didn't have as big a problem as everybody else in there did. I mean, I thought, man, I'm in the wrong place. But it helped me in knowing that I wasn't as crazy as everybody said I was. And I wasn't as screwed up as everybody said I was.
Isn't their advice when you get out to not go back to the lifestyle that you were engaged in prior to going in?
Well, of course, that's the whole point of being, hopefully coming out. But they don't want you to start dating within a year, to do anything different for a whole year. I mean, performing.
Okay, but
anything. I did all those things when I got out.
Yeah, when you came out, you really, the one thing you looked forward to was going to the Academy of Country Music Awards show.
Yeah.
Because they had offered you an opportunity.
Yeah, well, they asked me to be on the show, but the thing was, I was up for a Grammy. I was up for I Won't Take Less Than Your Love. I was up for a Female Vocalist of the Year at the Grammys. And I Won't Take Less Than Your Love became number one while I was in there. And
you mean you had your records went on and became hits?
And that became Johnny Cash had written the theme song for Betty Ford when they would play at what they call the burning, which is where you burn everything that you've written for the last few weeks, and everybody sings this song that Johnny Cash wrote, and they changed the song to I Won't Take Less Than Your Love. Again, I could hear it at night when people, because the next day when people would leave at night in different sections of the compound, you could hear people sing, I won't take less, you know, celebrating the burning that someone was leaving the next day.
You burned your most...
Diaries.
Your diary, intimate notes.
All that stuff, yeah.
All right, you're going to come out now. You're going to go to the Academy of Country Music Awards, and you're going to sing, and it's going to be a real coming out party for you, isn't it?
Well, I really didn't think about it too much. I mean, they were saying not to, and my counselor had said, you know, he had told me that he was concerned about it. He had voiced his concerns, and I said, well, it's a great opportunity for me. I'm going to do it.
You had to have a dress. You got a dress.
I had Saks Fifth Avenue. I called him and I said, bring me some things.
But
of course, they got stopped at the front.
You didn't have any shoes.
I did not have any shoes, and they had to run get me some shoes, and I swear to you, I'm standing there backstage with no shoes on, waiting, and I swear, they said, Tanya, you got to go now. And just as they did that, someone slipped a pair of shoes on me like that, and I stumbled off.
No, I don't know much about love, but at least I learned one thing. If it don't come easy, you better let it go.
That was a nice moment of triumph. Had to make you feel good. Did you want to say, there, I told you I could do it?
Well, I think I was just so glad to get it done.
Alpha Hydrax is just...
Ben Reed, he's the father of your children.
Yes.
How did you meet Ben?
I met him in Tulsa. I had done a show with a movie for television with a guy named Jeff McKay, who was good friends with Ben because they grew up and he was from Tulsa. So he brought Ben to meet me that night. I thought, well, oh, how nice, you know? Because I thought he's cute and I thought you guys might like meeting. And I said, well, you're right about him being cute.
Well, tell me about Presley. How did Presley happen?
Presley was conceived on my birthday at the Opryland Hotel.
Obviously, the two of you really
after the
were...
CMA, it was on the CMA Awards that night.
You were very attracted to each other.
Oh, yeah. Well, I was in love with him.
Okay. And... I assume Presley was named after Elvis.
Yeah. Presley was just a name I'd always thought would be great for a little girl or a little boy. But I definitely made deal with God that I wanted a little girl. Because, of course, Ben and I weren't together at that point, and I just didn't want to have another reminder of him around, you know?
At one time, you tried to repress his identity.
I did that for him and for me. I mean, we weren't together. It wasn't very fair to just plaster his name, and I knew he was struggling to get his own career going, and we hadn't really talked up to that point. I mean, Presley was 9 months old before he really saw her, and before I got that call.
Okay, I assume he comes back into your life, wouldn't he?
Yeah, he met me on September 1 at the Jerry Lewis telethon in L.A. I'd flown to L.A., and he was at the hotel waiting for me. Of course, Presley was already in Branson, which is where I was going after that. And he said, you know, I hear I have a little girl. And I said, yeah, you do. And I said, she's going to be in Branson if you want to see her. I mean, go with me. I'll buy your plane ticket. I'll buy you a plane ticket. Because, of course, he was struggling at that time. And so we did. We flew to Branson. And Presley, they brought her to the airport. And it was the first time that they'd seen each other.
Has he become close to his kids?
Oh, very much. Oh, yeah.
Well, we've got to get another person into this story, and that's Bo Grayson.
Bo Grayson, he's something.
When was he conceived?
He was conceived on January 5th in Santa Fe.
Okay.
Yeah.
Apparently you and Ben are back together now.
We got back together briefly, long enough to get pregnant, and then I was...
And Bo...
And he wanted to get married, and I wasn't convinced that he'd come back for me. You know, in fact, we talked about this the other night. I go, you know, I wasn't really convinced that you'd come back for me. You'd come back just because you were a daddy, you know, with Presley. And he goes, oh, I came back for the mama. So we talked. We still talk about it. I mean, we're still questions that we have to constantly keep answering. And it's like, well, that's what I thought then, but what do I feel like now? So we're still in that... In that stage, I don't know where it's going to fit in the end, but or in the big picture. But I know that I have all these beautiful pictures of us around with the kids, and I think, God, we're wasting a lot of time, you know.
What would you like to see happen?
Well,
that's tough.
It's a catch 22 because I want to see happen whatever is going to be best for all of us. You know, my children are going to be happy no matter what. I mean, I'm going to make them, they see him and they're with me and they have a pretty balanced life. But as far as between us, I mean, we're still talking about that. And
okay.
And if I would be courageous enough to say what I would like to happen would probably be that we would get back together and that we would be married and we would have two more kids.
Wow. Nice plan.
Twins, preferably.
You know, that was a banner day for you, and I want to go back to the CMAs. You had Bo around 1 o'clock in the afternoon. That night, it's CMA award time, and I want to go to the Grand Ole Opry House, and we'll find on stage Roy Rogers and Clint Black, who are presenting the Female Vocalist of the Year award.
It's a great moment.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Five very beautiful and very talented ladies are nominated for Female Vocalist of the Year, and it's our privilege to present the award. And the nominees are... Would have never found you. Patti Loveless.
Time passes by.
Kathy Mattea. Reba McEntire. Lori Morgan. Lori Morgan. And there's one more, Tanya Tucker. Did we mention Tanya Tucker?
Tanya Tucker.
She already has one prize today. This afternoon, Tanya had a beautiful baby boy. She named Bo after her dad.
Yeah.
So you want to tell us who the award goes to?
This is the interesting part. I'm glad he had to read all that because I can't see anyway.
You got one good eye there, Roy.
Yeah. I'll be doggone. Baby and all, Tanya Tucker.
You know she's watching. You know she's watching you.
You want something?
You know she's watching from a hospital bed, and I know she's real happy. And on behalf of Bo and her daughter Presley, we'll accept this for her. Way to go, Tanya.
Were you watching from the hospital bed?
Yes, I was. What was amazing was the night before. I checked in the night before. And I had called Clint. I'd called Lisa. And for some reason, they were buying a house or something, I can't remember. But no one knew that I was going to name my baby after my dad, except my sister. She knew, she was the only one that knew. And I thought, well, it's not, you know, not before. Who could, why not say it now? So I told Clint, he answered the phone, and he said, you know, I'm going to be introducing Female Vocalist of the Year tomorrow. He said, I sure do hope I get to call your name. And I said, well, I know where you live, boy. You better do it. And I said, you know, it's amazing. I said, but I tell you a little secret. I'm naming my boy after my dad. I'm naming him Bo Grayson. So my dad had no idea. So at this point, when he announced that I'd named my child after my dad falls off the couch because he had no idea.
Album called Complicated, and you are that.
Yeah. Simply Complicated.
What's the single from this?
The first single's called Little Things. Basically about I don't need the money and riches. I need a little smile, a little I love you, a little single kiss, a single rose. Those things are what really works with me. Little things. There's some, you know, every song on this album, it's my 30th album, and I have so many irons in the fire. I have my salsa company going.
Oh, I didn't mention
the salsa.
My race
car, which we have our first race at Daytona, Tanya Tucker Salsa. It's in the new pop-top can. I'm going to show you this. I'm proud of it. See? You just pop this off.
Oh, okay.
Take it anywhere you want. And it's feisty.
Will it bite you?
No, not too bad. I wanted to put mild, medium, and no mercy.
What about your racing car?
Jeff Bodine is in our number 7 car, and we didn't have a great year last year, but we hope to have a good one this year. It's just the first time I've ever had my name on a car going 200 miles an hour around a racetrack, so I'm real happy about that.
You know, this book really is going to deserve a sequel at some point down the road. You're going to have to write the rest of it.
After those people die.
Well, no, I'm thinking more in terms of your kids getting older.
Yeah.
Your career moving on. Maybe
well,
Ben,
I would like
maybe
to do that
Ben
too.
Reed back in.
Maybe.
To your life a little more.
Maybe. I mean, he definitely is looking that way.
You don't do things in a small way, do you?
No.
We've been celebrating on this program Nickel Dreams, Tanya Tucker's life. Of course, we didn't tell you everything. The book is rather lengthy, and you're going to have to go buy it and get the rest of the story for yourselves. But it's a wonderful book. Tanya, I thank you for coming to our show.
Thank you, Ralph. You're always my wonderful hero.
Ladies and gentlemen, Tanya Tucker.
Thank you.
Totally rock. You know who's on the cover of TV Guide? Me! So weird. I walk by the newsstand, I see it. It's like, it looks like one of those fake ones you get at Great Adventure. But here's one that was sent to my house. Look. Get a close-up of that? It's me with the chin hair. Look. This is my chin hair right there. Look. Let's see if I can get it. There it is! Look!
Oh! That's it.
Oh, jeez.
I think I'm crazy. I know I think I'm crazy.
Oi.
It's my favorite song. And has been a major force in country music for 25 years. This is her new CD, Complicated. Please welcome the amazing Tanya.
Love can't be measured with diamonds and gold. Before you spend your money, ought to let you know if you wanna get to me. Try the little thing. Don't need that mansion on top of the hill. Too many rooms with nothing to fill. You can furnish me with the little things.